Greetings, my friends. Today I thought it would be interesting to talk about Geiger counters. Geiger counters are a thing that most people at least have heard of and are familiar with in terms of things like movies and television, especially if you've seen shows like Chernobyl and so forth. But most of us have never actually used one or have had very limited experience with them, and even fewer people know how they work. And so I thought it would be interesting to go over not only the principles of how a Geiger counter works, but to show you an actual Geiger counter in operation. So the first thing that we need to understand is that Geiger counters detect radiation, which I think most of us knew. The types of radiation that Geiger counters can detect are alpha radiation, beta radiation, and gamma radiation. Alpha radiation is very, very short range and cannot penetrate even your skin or even a piece of paper. Alpha radiation will be stopped by almost anything, and so it's really actually fairly difficult to detect alpha radiation unless you have specific setups. Now, I shouldn't say it's difficult to detect. It's just difficult to have equipment that can do it, because in order to do so, you need to have openings into the sensors that are more or less difficult to maintain, because they have very, very delicate shields made out of things like mica and so forth. So alpha detecting Geiger counters are not as common. You can buy them, but they tend to be more expensive. Beta and gamma radiation are much easier to detect with a hobbyist level type Geiger counter and Geiger tube, and that's what I'll be showing you today. Beta radiation will go further than alpha radiation and will go through things like wood and paper and even some metal, not very thick metal, and it certainly won't penetrate lead. Gamma radiation will actually go through quite a few things, and depending on how strong it is and how far away from the source you are, it can penetrate fairly deeply. The bulk of what we will be looking at will be beta radiation, because there's not too many gamma sources that I would have sitting around the house. I do have some good sources for radiation that you'll see here in a few minutes, so it's very you'll find that very interesting. So Geiger counters are actually named after a specific man, Hans Geiger, who created the first Geiger tube. Now, he didn't create it in the sense of trying to create a radiation sensor. It was sort of like something that came out of other experiments. And they were learning about how radioactivity interacts with various gases and so forth. A man named Walter Mueller, who was a PhD student of Hans Geiger, helped him to refine and perfect the design of what we now know as the Geiger-Mueller tube. Most people just call it a Geiger tube, but the technical term is a Geiger-Mueller tube, because they kind of designed it together. So the principle of operation of a Geiger-Mueller tube, and this diagram is awful, but you know, it should serve, is that you have a tube where you've removed most of the air and replaced it with a gas that can be ionized easily. So these become, if you've heard the term, a gas discharge tube. So you've got low pressure and a gas inside the tube. One end of the tube is the anode that you charge to a very high voltage. Usually, I've put 400 to 600 volts here, but they can be anywhere from 100 to thousands of volts, depending on the type of tube and how sensitive it is and other parameters. But you will apply a high voltage to the anode, and there will be a wire going down the center of the tube. It does not go all the way to the other end. The cathode, or the negative terminal, will generally be either a plate at the end or will be connected to the shell of the tube and acts as the ground. And so what happens is that when you apply a very large voltage across this, no current will be flowing because there's no direct connection. But when radiation flows through or goes through the tube, in this case, I've drawn the alpha particle here as hitting the thing and bouncing off, because as we said earlier, alpha particles, they won't even penetrate paper, let alone the metal skin of a Geiger tube like that. Beta and gamma radiation, however, can, and then they go in here, and these little starbursts are my silly attempt at writing an interaction event where this particle will strike a particle of the gas and causes it to ionize, which then causes other particles of gas to ionize and creates basically a discharge inside the tube that can be detected as a pulse of electricity at the cathode. So beta and gamma radiation are capable of causing that to happen. And when that happens is the classic click sound from most Geiger counters, or you can then begin counting it, which is why it's called a Geiger counter. And the thing about Geiger counters is that they are actually, when they are properly configured and properly calibrated using a known level of radiation, you can get them calibrated to be able to detect actual levels of radiation. Like, this is how much radiation is coming from this source or from this thing or is in this environment. For anything like this hobbyist, Geiger counter that you make at home, you're not going to be able to calibrate it like that. And so all you're really doing is counting raw events. And even then, you're not going to be totally certain that you're getting it accurate. All you can really use these for is detecting relative levels of radiation. So never, ever rely on one of these for any kind of safety. These are for hobby and fun applications only. So once again, just to recap, a Geiger-Müller tube is essentially a tube filled with a near vacuum with some gas in it, and the gas is sensitive to radioactive particles going through. When those radioactive particles go through and interact with the gas, they cause a discharge, making this a gas discharge tube, go figure, that then you can pick up here on this thing that I've just written as a box that says impulse detector, and then that can generate a sound or a click or a chirp or can flash a light. So that is the basic principle of operation of a Geiger counter. You will see other types of tubes. This is the kind here that we've got, this long one, and I'll show that to you in more detail in just a moment. There are also tubes that have a window at the end that you hold as a sort of almost like a flashlight and point at the radiation source. And those are going to be organized a little bit differently inside, and they will have a clear window at one end, usually made out of a substance like mica, like I said earlier. Those can detect alpha radiation because substances like mica and certain other types of substances that can not only stand up to the difference in pressure, that's the big thing, is you need something that can handle the pressure difference of being one atmosphere and then having very, very low pressure gas inside, as well as allow particles through. And those kinds of substances aren't super common, and they tend to be kind of delicate. They don't really stand up well to shock and so forth. So alpha detecting Geiger counters, Geiger-Müller tubes, are a little bit more expensive, and they're more delicate. There are also what are called pancake tubes, and they would just be like a disc or a puck-like device, and they're intended to maximize the surface area of the window, the sensor window, to the internals and the gas, and those can be used in various different configurations as well. They also, again, tend to be more expensive. Like, you can get one of these tubes here for like $15, I think. The pancake tubes I've seen go for $200-$300. So it really just depends on what it is that you're trying to do and what kinds of applications you have. There are also counters that can detect things like neutron and other types of radiation, but those are specialized applications that require additional things be done to either create a chain where the neutron isn't actually being detected directly, but is creating events that are then detected, and that gets a little bit more complicated than we want to for this video. So we're just going to talk about alpha, beta, and gamma, and really we're only talking about beta and gamma because that's all I can pick up with this Geiger counter. Now this is a home Geiger counter kit that you can get from a site called Mighty Ohm, and it's really cool. I just want to say right now, I have no connection with them. We have never spoken. I'm not trying to shill their products. This is just a cool little kit that you can get either pre-built, or you can get one if you like soldering like I do, and you can put it together yourself. They'll send you the whole kit. You can assemble it, and it comes with a Geiger-Müller tube. This is an SBM-20, and I don't know what SBM stands for, but these are Soviet Union era new old stock. They were made in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and so these are all over the place coming out of the former USSR. this kit is great because you can put it together yourself. It's really, really simple, and it's a lot of fun. If you have basic soldering skills and can follow instructions, you can make your own Geiger counter. So as I said before, what you need to be able to operate a Geiger-Müller tube, this is the Geiger-Müller tube here that I'm pointing at with my tweezers. The Geiger-Müller tube requires a very, very large operating voltage. It needs almost no current. That's not the point. You just need the large difference in voltage from the anode to the cathode in order for the gas discharge effect inside to operate as it should. So in the case of this one, you need anywhere, depending on how sensitive you want it to be, for this tube, you need it to be about 150 to 300 volts. Now, how am I going to generate that from these two little batteries? Well, you can do that using something called a boost converter. And so part of the circuit over here on the left is using a 555 timer IC to generate a timed pulse that then is used to switch back and forth through this diode. And this black thing here is an inductor. That's a coil in there. You might be able to see just a tiny little dot of copper there. And this capacitor is helping it as well. And essentially, this makes it a switched mode power supply. It's switching back and forth between the inductor and the capacitor and diodes very, very quickly. And I'll do another video about the specifics of boost converters and so forth later at another time. But for now, you can take this 3 volts and generate 300 or 400 volts out of it at very low current, which means it's safe for me to handle this. Even if I did manage to get a shock, it would just be a little sting. It wouldn't kill me or do much harm. It might sting quite a bit, but it wouldn't kill me because it really just can't generate enough current to do any damage. So that voltage is applied here, and then this tube, here's the cathode. At this end, if you look under here, you can actually see that this clip connects through on this trace to other brackets. This is for different types of tubes, so they can sell this kit with the same board with shorter tubes, which I think is kind of interesting. But then that impulse that is picked up from this end of the tube, it goes on that trace underneath there to this capacitor and these resistors and so forth. And this section of the circuit is a impulse detector. It literally detects the impulses of electricity out of here and sends them to this, this is an ATtiny microcontroller. And that's the oscillator for it. The blue thing there generates a clock signal. So there's actual code written that you can go and download. That's another thing. They make this thing public, open source. So you can go and download it from their public site. And it drives this LED and generates a chirp, and you can turn the chirp on and off with this button. But I think that's enough talking about it for now. Let's take a look at it in action. So to turn it on, I just do this. And in a moment, there we go, it'll start making some chirp noises. When it actually starts doing that can be fairly random, but I wanted to show you here, I've got a multimeter, and I said before, this thing will generate several hundred volts. Let's take a look at that. So I'm going to put this in here because that's going to be ground. And then over here, they actually need to keep it there. Over here on the board, you can probably see it if you look carefully. That says TP2, test point 2. And that's going to be the high voltage. As you can see, it's generating 296 volts. Let me move this to where it's actually more easily seen. If I can do this without getting my hand in the way. And keep it in place. Yeah, 296 volts, which is pretty interesting. Now I can leave that there. The way that this thing operates is there's a resistor here that I can change the resistance of it. And this is what allows you to adjust the sensitivity. Watch the voltage as I turn this to the left. The voltage drops. The voltage will drop, and now when I take this off of here, far fewer events, in fact, almost none. What you do, there was one. So the higher the voltage, the more sensitive it is. I've found that this one seems to work as, you know, optimally as I can get it at about 300 volts. But you know what? Your mileage may vary. This is the kind of thing that, again, you don't need this thing to be super, super precise. You just want it to be sensitive enough to pick up major changes in radiation. Now, the next question you might ask is, well, if I've got a Geiger counter, how do I know the difference between background radiation and regular radiation, or just regular radiation, between background radiation and actual sources that would be of interest? Because right now what it's picking up is basically just general background radiation. I could turn down the sensitivity, it would pick up less. I could turn up the sensitivity, it would chirp more, but that's basically just adjusting where I want the baseline to be. But there are many things in your home or might be around that actually have radioactivity in them, and you might be surprised at what those might be. For example, I have this compass. This is a compass from the 1960s, I believe, and it's a U.S. Army Lensatic compass. These compasses were made with a substance called radium on the dials. That radium allowed it to glow in the dark. They use a different technology now to make them glow in the dark, but these things, even though they no longer glow, are still radioactive. See, notice how much, when I get it close to the dial, it goes absolutely bananas. But here's the thing to know about it. First off, this amount of radiation is not very dangerous, especially considering, watch this, it's almost on it right now, but if I move it up an inch, a couple inches, before it even gets out of the frame, we're practically back to background levels of radiation, because the distance and power and so forth drops off really, really rapidly with one of these. And so it's kind of cool, though. I mean, that's kind of fun to look at and to know. And, you know, there's lots of other things in your home that contain radiation. For example, smoke detectors. Smoke detectors, most of them these days use something called americium, which is a highly radioactive alpha emitter. Remember, we talked earlier about alpha emitters, so I can't hold this up to a smoke detector and pick anything up because the alpha particles can't get in here. You know, see, if I touch it, that grounds it and causes it to set off. So, but yes, alpha particles can't get in here, so you can't really use this for testing your smoke detector. If I had an end window or pancake type, and I put it next to a smoke detector, it would go absolutely bananas, most likely, because americium is radioactive, not highly so, they're very safe, but it does have radiation in it. But something that a lot of people have in their homes, or may have at your father's home or your grandparents' home that you did not know about or were unaware of, is, look at this, I'm going to turn this off for a second. This is uranium glaze. There is radioactive uranium in this glaze. That's what one of the things that helps give it its color. If you find old orange pottery or older orange ceramics with orange glaze like this, and they've got like this green pitting in here, this is radioactive. Now, you'll sometimes find this on old plates and so forth that people would eat off of called fiesta ware. And so nobody uses this to eat off of or drink out of anymore because, you know, it is not probably the safest thing to do. That said, it's not super dangerous. We're not talking about like Chernobyl levels of radiation here. Nobody's going to say, you know, 3.6 Roentgen, you know, it's not good, not bad. This is very, very low levels. But again, you probably don't want to be eating off of this because if you were to ingest little tiny flakes of it or something like that, it would be really bad for you. But take a look at this. I'm going to turn the thing back on and put it down. Watch this. See? Radioactive ceramics. So if you've got one of these little Geiger counters and you want to test your old ceramics or go by your parents' house and wave it over the hutch with all the goodies in it that sits there year after year, you might find yourself surprised. Now here's another one. This one also has uranium glaze on it. This one's a little bigger. And so it's kind of interesting though, you can see more or less where the radioactivity is. Notice that there's less of it down here on the bottom. And here's another interesting thing. Like if I go and put it here on the outside where the glaze is, it goes bananas. But look, if I put it in here, almost no change at all. Just a tiny, tiny little uptick. But it doesn't really seem to be picking up, you know, even when I put it like right next to this. And that's because the particles, these alpha particles, they're not making it even through the ceramic. But they can go through the air and travel into the tube. So that is very interesting stuff. If you have one of these kits, they're really fun. You can either get them pre-assembled, like I said, or you can get one that you put together yourself. And there are other kits out there that follow similar design guidelines and stuff, so you can kind of make your own. Or you can just buy one of these SBM-20 tubes. They are all over the place, and there are variations on things that you can get. They're not terribly expensive. Setting up the circuit to drive it, not super difficult if you have any kind of electronics know-how or anything like that. But, you know, on balance, I'd say probably the easiest way to do it would just be to get a kit if you just kind of want to experiment. Now, if you want to get a real Geiger counter, be prepared to spend a few $100 at the least. And then if you want to calibrate it, you're going to have to buy an actual calibrated radiological source and go through all kinds of craziness. So, you know, for those of us though that just kind of like want to wave a piece of stuff at a ceramic pot and have it make noise, well, you know, this will make us happy. So there it is. There's the basic principles of operation of a Geiger counter with a quick demonstration of it. I hope you enjoyed this and found it informative. If you are interested, please like and subscribe. I plan to make many, many more videos about hobby electronics and principles of electronics in the future. So if you are able to join me for that, I think that would be great. Oh, I just noticed that there's a dent in my tube. So clearly it doesn't affect its operation much, so that's good. All right, well, thank you again for tuning in. I hope you have a wonderful day.